Hi, welcome to the part 6 of this video series. We are covering AZ 304 important exam questions. The chances of same or similar questions coming in the exam is very high. Please subscribe to my channel. For questions 1 to 40, please refer parts 1 to 5 of this video series. Let's look at this question. The first thing you have to do is identify the keywords. So here, first let's understand the story before we identify the keywords. So this says you have virtual machine that will run SQL Server and will contain two data disks. So it's like you have a virtual machine and it has two data disks, and this virtual machine is having a SQL Server database put on it. And then you see disk 1 stores log files and disk 2 stores data. These are SQL data, and we have to give a caching solution for these two. These P40 disks, these are high performance block storage disks. But this is not the keyword. So this is the keyword. You need to recommend a caching policy. So for log files, out of these, what should be the caching policy? And for data, what should be the caching policy? If you see in this diagram, the virtual machine's logs are kept in data disk 1. So now these logs can be generated every minute. So if you cached the log data at say 10 a.m. in the morning, and if you are trying to access the cache, it will give you the log file data that was relevant for 10 a.m. But now it is 2 p.m. and you know that in terms of viewing the logs, it has to be in the moment. I mean, there is not much of use if you view logs which are old. Even couple of hours old does not serve the purpose at many times. So there is no use of caching, because you put something in cache and it goes obsolete every 15-20 minutes, because logs has to be in the moment, very current. So for the log, I think none should be the answer, because there is no use of caching the logs. Now with respect to data, data has to be cached for sure, and data caching helps. For example, if there is a Power BI report accessing this data, it will help. If you cache it, it will help in reading, or it will help in fast reads. It will improve the performance of reports, because instead of the SQL being passed to the database and the database running that query and then sending the results, Power BI can straight away hit the log, the cache, and from the cache it will get the data. So for data, it should be read only. Like in our example, we saw Power BI is reading the data. Cache, I never saw cache being a read and write both. Write happens directly to the database, either through AZ copy or ADF, that is data factory. But write doesn't happen in the flow that you first write it in the cache and then through cache it goes to the database. It doesn't happen that way. So cache is either no cache or read only. The main purpose of caching is to help other applications read the data from the database faster. So instead of hitting the database, the data is already in cache, and that improves the time to retrieve the data. So this is the answer: none and read only. So let's see this question. So the question is saying you want to store a blob storage for many years and the stored data will be accessed rarely. So usually what happens is, if you have an archive requirement where your old data has to be archived for 7 years, so we put it in archive tier because it is rarely accessed. But the story changes in this line. This is the keyword. It is saying, even though it is accessed rarely, whenever it is accessed, it has to be an immediate access. That means if you have to access it, the client does not want to wait for 5 hours or 6 hours to get that data. They want it immediate. So you can put your data in archive layer or archive tier, but the minimum commitment is 180 days. Then you cannot keep it for 30 days and then delete it. So if you see this, it says it should be stored for at least 180 days, and it has flexible latency requirements. So that means if you want it to be, the data to be retrieved in 8 hours, you can do it. If you want it in 5 hours, you can do it. But it is always in the order of hours. It is not immediate. If you see the archive tier, it offers lowest storage cost but highest access costs and high latency. That means if you only keep it there if you know that you will access it rarely, and whenever you access it, you pay high access cost, and your latency is also high because you will have to wait. You will have to put a request and wait for 5 hours or 8 hours for that data to come through. So if you see this keyword immediate access, that means you will have to switch to either hot tier or cool tier. So if I compare between cool and hot, hot will be expensive because we are asking here to minimize storage cost. So hot is expensive than cool. So our answer should be cool, because cool allows you to access the data immediately, that is provisioned here, and the data has to be there for at least 30 days. So this is our final answer, option A. We will move forward. Let's look at this question. We need to identify the keywords first. So you have a web apps application which is on Azure, and then you have a SQL server which is on-prem. This is on-prem, okay. And then what the question says is, this SQL server you want to move in Azure. That's why I put it blue. All blue color is Azure, so that web apps can use SQL server in Azure. So which option would suffice? So let's understand the keywords here. So for me, the keywords here are, so these are the keywords which are important for decision making. See, the first thing is, when you move into Azure, your SQL server will not be in a Docker container for sure. So in Docker container, you usually put your web page codes, or web application codes, etc. You never put a database inside a Docker container. So A and B both are wrong. Okay, this question is not about using a Docker for database. So A and B are wrong. E is wrong because it just says Azure. There are better options than it. So just on Azure means nothing. Okay. So let us see between C and D, because we are left with C and D. So C is same SQL Server but on a VM, and D is SQL managed database instance. So C says this SQL Server, they would put it on a VM. The problem with that is, if you see the keywords, you cannot do auto patching and auto backup. These are not available. You will have to create some programs or mechanism to do it. But D is a better option, because this SQL database managed instance has these inbuilt. So Azure manages the backup services, patching and version updates. So this is the right answer. We will move forward. So let's look at this question. This gives you an architecture. This is the flow as to these are the log files, and via data factory it enters data lake storage, then it hits Databricks for prep and training purpose, and then it is reported using Power BI, or it also flows to Synapse Analytics, and it's a to and fro motion. It's a bi-directional move, and then it also goes to analysis services from where Power BI reports are created. So here they have given you what is the, so this gives you a plan type, and this gives you the cost for each service. For example, if you see the most expensive service is Data Factory. It is costing $4,900 and something. Remaining are like $475, $735, like that. So this is the question, okay? And what it is saying is you need to minimize costs. So it says 1 GB of logs are generated per day. These logs are from Apache web servers. The log files are in consistent format, and you want to minimize the cost while the functionality should be the same. Let's look at the options. Even if I don't look at the options, I showed you where will I reduce the cost, because this is the most expensive operation. The question says it's a consistent format. So from here to the data lake, you can use AZ copy. No need of data factory. AZ copy is a much cheaper option, because there is no transformation needed to change the file format and so on. It is just a copy and put it to the data lake. But let's look at the options. So for me, the option here would be this option C. So replace data factory with cron jobs that use AZ copy. This is my option. But let's look at other options. Option A, replace Azure Synapse and analysis service with SQL Server on VM. So Synapse is just costing $998, this one. And then you want to replace it with SQL. So that will not suffice. They are saying replace these two services, you see this, these two, with just one service, that is SQL Server on VM.
So it will not achieve the functionality. Synapse is used for very high performance data warehouse systems. Okay, so SQL Server cannot do this same job. That's why this option is wrong. Let's look at option B. So this is again saying replace Synapse with Azure SQL Database Hyperscale. So it will not work. Like I explained in option A, this service is not consuming the bulk of the cost. It is just $998. And if you replace this with SQL, even if it is hyper plan, it will still not suffice because this is a data warehouse system. It is a columnar database. Hyperscale is not columnar, and even if you use hyperscale, it will not perform the same tasks that Synapse does. Synapse stores huge volumes of data in columnar format, very ideal for data warehouse systems. SQL database is ideal for ODS, or ODS means operational data store, or OLTP types data sets. So you can use SQL if you have a web app or a mobile app. You can use SQL as its backend, that is real time or OLTP systems. But replacing Synapse is not an option here. The option D suggests replace Azure Databricks with ML. Databricks, if you see this last service, it is costing around $515. It's a bit cut out, but it's costing $515. Not very expensive. And then replacing it with ML. So if you use Databricks, you get a good capacity for holding the data and performing transformations, etc. So Databricks cannot be a one-on, or ML cannot be a one-on-one replacement for Databricks because you will not achieve the same functionality. So if you see this machine learning, you can use it for a pre-trained model, but Azure Databricks, you can build and deploy models, and you can also have data workflows using integrations. So Azure Databricks has slightly different functionality. It is a Spark-based platform, and this is a managed platform, especially for machine learning. Hence, option D is also wrong. So we will lock option C as our final answer. So let's look at the next question. You may pause the video. Let us first understand this story. So in this question, your company plans to use Elastic Pools and SQL databases. So you will have Elastic Pool with some SQL databases, a lot of them. So there are 30 customers, and each customer should have their own database. So at least there will be 30 database. You need to design a storage solution, and cost must be minimized. So for me, this is the keyword. Operational cost must be minimized. That is one. And the customer databases will be one of the following regions. So these database can be in one of the following regions. And now they are asking, what is the minimum number of Elastic Pools? So minimum number is the keyword of Elastic Pools and SQL database servers required. It is not asking about SQL databases required. For SQL databases, if each customer, there are 30 customers. You see this? There are 30 customers. So, and each customer should have their own database. This one. So number of databases could be 30, but it is not asking about databases. It is asking about database servers and Elastic Pools and minimum number, not the apt number. It is minimum by which you can get the same functionality with which will help you minimize the operational cost. So first we have to understand that Elastic Pool is inside the database servers. So first you set up the database servers, then you have Elastic Pools. Inside Elastic Pools you have databases. This is the hierarchy. So the first thing here is it is asking how many minimum number of Elastic Pools out of this. So 30 cannot be an answer, because 30 would be number of databases, not pools. Now out of 1, 3, 6 and 10, see, there are three regions, okay, and in each region you will need one Elastic Pool in each region. So the answer should be 3, because the customer databases will be in one of the three regions. You cannot have an Elastic Pool in one region. See, Elastic Pool will have some databases, like 30 databases. It cannot be that 10 databases are in US, East US, 10 in North Europe and 10 in South Africa. It cannot happen in Elastic Pool. It has to be in the same region. So due to this constraint, and your customers can be in any of these three Azure regions, due to this constraint, you will have to put an Elastic Pool in each region. Okay, so you will need 3 Elastic Pools and database servers also 3, because Elastic Pools will be residing on database servers. So 3, 1 for each region. So if someone is in North Europe, okay, that customer is in North Europe and they cannot access a database, they cannot have a database inside an Elastic Pool, and that Elastic Pool is in East US. That Elastic Pool has to be in North Europe. If the Elastic Pool has to be in North Europe, that means a database server is required in North Europe also. Keeping that concept in mind, this is our final answer. 3 and 3. So let's move to the next question. So you have a VM1. It stores 500 GB of data files, and this is on Windows Server 2019. And then you have to put a data factory, an Azure data factory, to move these files to a data lake. ADL is Azure Data Lake. Okay, so this is the question. And now we have understood the story. The pain point here is they want to deploy on VM, like what should you deploy on VM1 to support the design out of these? In order to support this design, what should you deploy? Okay, so see, whenever I see these questions, no, the first thing that comes to my mind is integration runtime, because this is meant for such purposes only. The self-hosted integration runtime. So if you see this documentation, so this integration runtime is a compute infrastructure, okay, and this is used by data factory. So this data factory will use the compute infrastructure of self-hosted runtime. Primarily, it provides data integration capabilities across different environments. For example, you can run copy activities between a cloud data store and data store in private network, and it also works with on-premises network or on an Azure virtual network. It works with everything. See, for me, D is the right answer, but we should also look at other options why they are wrong. So let's look at option C first, on-prem data gateway. So if there was anything like this VM1, if this was on-premises and you had to use ADF on Azure Cloud, then it would make sense, because then you would need a data gateway on-prem to perform this communication. But that is not the case. Everything is on Azure platform. So C is wrong. Let's see option B, Azure File Sync Agent. See, if we had Azure File Share and this communication to happen between VM1 and Azure file share, then this file sync agent is useful. But that is not the business case or use case here. So B is wrong. In our use case, we have to integrate with EDF and move the files via EDF to data lake. Now let us look at option A, Azure Pipelines Agent. So this is used with DevOps. If you want to deploy your code, you can use pipeline and pipeline agents. Here the use case doesn't have anything to do with DevOps. So we will lock our answer as self-hosted integration runtime. Let's look at this question. So for me, these are the keywords. The network connectivity issues, and we need to analyze network traffic. But what is the story? So the story goes this way. You have some VMs on-prem and you have some VMs on Azure. That's why this entire stuff is blue, because this is on Azure. And how these two are talking to each other is through Azure Express route. Now there are some connectivity issues when you talk across this. Suppose this VM2 is talking to this VM1. There are connectivity issues and you want to analyze what is the problem. So this question gives you the solution. They are saying use Azure Advisor. See, when the question says you need to analyze network traffic, why? Because you want to determine whether the packets are being allowed or denied by the VMs or to the VMs. So if this is supposed to happen, then you need something sort of network tracer or network watcher. Advisor will not help you to analyze network traffic. See, Advisor is just a personalized cloud consultant and it helps you follow best practices to optimize your deployments on Azure. So primarily these three things, if you see, you can get proactive best practice recommendations. It improves the performance, security posture. You can get recommendations with proposed actions in line. Nothing to do with analyzing the network traffic. Hence, this solution that the question has already given is wrong. The answer should be no. So this is the answer. We will log this and move forward. So the next question is the same question, but a different solution. This time, if you see this yellow stuff, they have given network watcher, which seems correct. And what it will do is it will run IP flow verify to analyze the network traffic. So if you see this documentation, network watcher is designed to monitor and repair the network health of IS infrastructure. This includes virtual machines also. Our question is using virtual machine. So we got our answer. So this is our answer. So please subscribe to my channel. If you have any constructive comment, then please drop. If you have any appreciations as well, then please put in your comments. This brings us towards the end of part 6. I will post some more parts shortly.